connecting to cloud server. Okay, so these clusters, we name it that the left hand side cluster is Apple and the right hand side cluster could be non-Apples. It's less complex, lesser human intervention, but sometimes it becomes less accurate and results cannot be ascertained. For example, if I want to know who among my audience who are understanding whatever I'm telling or not telling, these kind of things can be ascertained by clustering the audience into various categories from science background, from non-science background, and then create an assumption that, oh, probably people from physics background are understanding me more than from non-physics. But this could be less accurate also. And the third is a reinforcement learning, which is a very advanced stage of machine learning, where you actually tune the model, you make the model also learn over time. So by telling again and again that this prediction has gone wrong, the computer takes that as an input, and the next time, not only the initial model is working, but also it has reinforced those observations on top of it. So as you can now understand that where it can go wrong, if continuously, if you feed in wrong results to the computer, then a well-learned model can learn wrong things. So these are all the different type of machine learning I have briefly touched upon. The basic steps of machine learning is, these are the 7 steps. I believe that if you know all of them, then you or your students can create a machine learning tool. And in fact, I'm very glad to tell all my audience that I have a class 12 student who has developed an AI tool which can read chest radiograph and find out various pathological conditions from the chest radiograph, class 12 student. So it's not a rocket science. If all of us understand what is there inside the black box, we can even develop our own model. So define the problem. Second step, gather the data, then clean it, train the model, test the model, evaluate, and deploy. These are the basic steps. It sounds easier than done, but I will now, in next 5 minutes, take you inside the black box. What is happening inside the machine learning algorithm? But I must warn all of you that this is an oversimplification of the AI model. It is correct, but then oversimplification. Something like this must be happening within the black box, for which the computer also learns like human. So going forward, here is what a typical machine learning AI algorithm tool looks like. Looks very complicated. Don't get frightened by looking at this heavily connected graphs. The first layer, the input layer, is a series of knobs. If any one of you have seen music recording in a studio, then you would have seen that that guy is actually lifting some, tuning each and every parameter to get the right kind of audio voice. So similarly here, the input layer is some data which it is getting from the input data, and in the middle layers they are getting tuned. The white, the one that is highlighted in the hidden layer, there are certain which are highlighted, certain rounds, and certain rounds which are not highlighted. So these highlight versus non-highlighting, I am representing in a cartoonic way, that they are learning and they are contributing toward the final output, which we call in a mathematical formula that the neuron is getting trained by the V1, V2, V3 knobs with the W1, W2, W3 weights, and then finally the output comes. When it's not clear, here is an example in front of you. Say there is an image of numeric 2. The image is there, which is a 28 pixel by 28 pixel. And I want to tell the computer, look at this image and tell me what is the number. Simple problem. Now, each of the pixel in this 28 cross 28, which is 784, are the input here. And as you can see, there is a black, white, or gray kind of intensity for each of the pixel, and those intensities goes inside the input layer, and they in turn fire certain neurons inside, that fire certain other neurons inside, and the output comes as 2. Now, what happens here? We tell the computer in the beginning that this is the image of 2, and this is the image of 7, and you determine which are the knobs should be fired within, so that the output will have 7 here, and output over here will be 2 here. So what is happening inside? Maybe, I'm using the word maybe, what is happening here is that these are the input images, A, B, C, and the computer inside is seeing an image with a hat, with a standing line, with these features. Whenever I see these kind of features, I don't know why the human beings are telling me this should be A. Whereas some other combination of features, they call it B. Whereas C doesn't have a hat, or C has a hat, but B maybe doesn't have. So these kind of has and have not has and have not finally determined A, B, C. So it breaks the image into very small tiny units and reconstruct it back so that it reaches back to the same image. And in this process, it tries to understand how to distinguish between various images, various labeled images. So this is the mathematical equation that goes inside. And with that, it actually trains. So basically, neural network is nothing but a set of weights, functions. That weight is what is being used for the testing purpose. Now, what happens when I give a very complicated image where the 7 is moved to the corner, it's not in the center, or a 2 is there, but then some other lines have come out because bachche ne wahan pe ek line khinch diya, something has come out. So then we cannot take that heuristic model which I just now explained. So we stop there. No, we then have a solution called convolutional neural network, CNN. Yeah, this term many of you would have heard, ANN, artificial neural network, CNN, convolutional neural network, and then deep learning. These are some of the terms you must be hearing day in, day out, YouTube, other channels, videos. So now what is this CNN over this ANN? Very simply, a simplified way of explaining you is that what it does, that it has a moving kernel, yellow kernel that you are seeing, which is moving, it actually scans the entire image. And then it tries to collect information where the information content is maximum. For example, I am speaking to you. And while I'm speaking to you, most of my background image is fixed. Only my lips are moving, and sometimes the hand may be coming. So if such a video is given to the computer and is asked whether this person is speaking or got disconnected, so what it will see that in series of images, background is always same and is now same, but the movement is, certain movements are not there. So maybe this disconnected. So that kind of learning happens, and this CNN helps it, the image to be spatially invariant. That means if I move to the left, move to the right, the kernel is able to capture my face. It's not that my face has to be always in the center. This moving kernel will do that. So if that is clear, so what it does, post convolution, there is a max pooling. So this is a kernel which has scanned this image, created smaller matrix, and from this smaller matrix, again a max pooling operation has happened by taking 4, 4, 4, and 4. The numbers that is maximum in a square is taken further. May sound complicated, but just imagine that in a big image, it is being scanned, and from that scanning, the important information is only captured. If you want to capture my face from the image, you capture the features of the face while I'm in the center, while I'm here, while I'm there. And that's the job of this kernel to do that. I hope I'm getting across to most of you, but in a digital class, not linger because I have to go further. So what it happens in reality is that this kind of convolution max pooling helps us in an image of a brain to identify where is the bone, where is the blood, where are the tissues. So different type of filters, different type of windows can be selected to maximize the information of different features in the medical images. That's why I explained to all of them that we are using different kernels, different type of filters to enhance certain features. While the entire image is useful, but filters are used to enhance those features. In brief, in short, the CNN is a group of convolution, max pooling, followed by a fully connected network, which I explained to you before, the fully connected network, the ANN part. Now my basic part is over. The one third of my talk is over. That these are all the ingredients or the spices of the recipe that I'm going to serve you now. Now, I'm not the only one who is working on this. If you look at the internet, AI and radiology keyword, you will find a huge number of literatures are available, and it is coming up. This graph, I got it from a publication which was till 2018, but in 2020, then you can always imagine it has gone up further. And India is also somewhere there in between. So a large number of publications are coming, which just involves artificial intelligence and radiology, these two keywords. If I put healthcare, agree, many more publications will come. Here are some sample publications for those who are more interested deep into this, for them, that from 2017 onwards till 2020, a large number of models are being developed worldwide. And from India also, some models have been developed, which reads the radiological images, chest X-ray, maybe your other kind of images, CT scans, MRIs, those images are being read by computers and is trying to learn and give verdicts as good as the radiologist. And we at IGIB thought of developing something at IGIB which can beat these models and maybe be there in the world map of AI in radiology. So we called it as Rapid City, and we positioned Rapid City software or the algorithm somewhere here. The patient comes, the CT scan image is taken. Is my mouse visible when I am circulating the mouse? Yes, okay. So this scan image then sends to PACS machine. And in a traditional method, the images from the PACS machine go to the radiologist terminal and the radiology give the report. But most interestingly, you'll be surprised to know that the ratio of radiologists to patients in our country is abysmally low. Some say it is one radiology per 1 lakh of patients, and some say very optimistically one radiologist for 50,000 patients. Anyway, you can see from either of the numbers, it's not that radiologists are plentifully available to see the radiographs of these patients, and places like remote villages, districts, you may not even have one radiologist per patient. So their radiographs are being seen by the technologists who actually operators who actually take the use the machine. In this scenario, it is very important for a country like us. We must develop a middle layer, which is here, which is not to replace the radiologist, but actually can assist the radiologist, because by the time the image reaches the table of the radiologist, then it can be prioritized. See, a patient is met with an accident on the road. Every second is important. Every minute is important. The cells, neuronal cells, are dying. And that patient's radiological images come to the doctor, but the doctor is seeing some other radiogram that time. And the amount of time lost could be fatal. So here, this method that we are proposing will put a red flag that it is highly emergent. Radiogram should be seen by doctor immediately. And with that kind of flag, if it reaches, then the doctor will leave everything else and will see this. So how it works? There are two ways that it can work. One is a very simple way, which is called binary. Whether there is a hemorrhage or there is no hemorrhage. Ha or na. And the second is a little more complicated. If it is hemorrhage, what kind of hemorrhage? Where it is located? Is it located in very important region of the brain, or it is somewhere else which can wait for more time? How much is the bleed, the quantity of the bleed? So all it requires is a development of a model, which could be binary or multi-class. It needs to have a localization, segmentation, prioritization. Don't get bogged down by the terminologies I'm using. I must tell you, to comfort all of you, by training, I am a chemist. I'm a chemistry student, did PhD in bioinformatics, and doing bioinformatics for 18 years. Last 2 years only, I'm learning the basics of radiology from doctors. So people can learn, and I welcome the change that country is actually making in allowing commerce student to enter to science or engineering student to get into other things, but that will not get into that debate. It will take a lot of time otherwise. But I'm welcoming that anybody can learn anything at any age. Having said that, coming back to the model development, these are the various type of model one can generate: 2D model, 2.5D model, 3D model. In very quick terms, let me tell you, a CT scan image is actually a series of images which you can almost understand it is like a video. What is a video? Video is a series of static images run through a loop. And that's how we see a video. So in CT scan also, various layers of the brain, there is a brain CT scan I'm talking about, then every layer is being photographed. And then you see it in such a way that as if you are seeing the entire brain from top layer to the bottom, front to the back, side to the side. So there are a series of images, 2D images, with some very thin cross section. So what I was explaining all these whiles are actually the 2D models. Each image is labeled, and you develop a model which will read the image and tell you whether there was a bleed or not. But in a 2.5 model, little advantage over two D model is that the AI tool doesn't just not see the image of interest, it also sees the previous image and the later image. And it tries to maximize the information. If this, there is a bleed in this particular image, then there has to be a trace in the previous image as well as the next image. So that way the error can be reduced. And of course, In 3D models, he sees the entire thing, entire patient, and gives the verdict. Every method has its own pros and cons, but nonetheless, people are working on developing models in all using all these aspects. At IGIV, the rapid CT model that we are developing actually is using the 2D model. It looks into each and every image and try to give that image whether there was a bleed or not. But pulling all the information of all the images, it tells the patient is having ICH or not. The patient level as well as image level prediction is happening. What we need to develop such a model, what we need is that we need a huge amount of labeled input data. Who will give us such labeled input data? I'm sorry to say that in our country, data sharing, making data available freely is not that much as a practice. We have never created that kind of a practice. We are starting now, but it is not there. So when I entered into this problem, first of all, begged, borrowed from friends, collaborators who are radiologists who are in hospital. Then I got across a data set, CQ500. And then, luckily, there was a competition at RSNA Kaggle, which is Radiological Society of North America, who gave 25,000 data sets, studies for developing models. And that came as a blessing, and then our model immediately learned quite a bit by looking into so many models, so many images. And as you can see, the data set is so rich that it has got binary label for each slice, multiple classification for hemorrhage into subtypes. It not only says that bleed or not, where it is the bleed is located, intraparenchymal, intraventricular, subarachnoid, subdural, epidural. So various images has got labels where it is, where the bleed is being seen. And now you will probably also understand now the problem is more like a puzzle, a mathematical computational puzzle, because the input data is available in such curated form, such clean way. All that is needed now, you start with some model which can distinguish a dog from a cat and take the model, initial values, variables, and ask it to learn to read radiological images, right? So we call it as transfer learning. You use a starting point and ask it to learn now, distinguish between other medical images. It's over. Model got developed. All that you needed is a computer. All that you needed, images, both are there. PhD students are very smart. And several models could be created in matter of months time. I mean, it should have been few weeks, but anyway, let's say months time. And then the accuracy level also, as you can see, is not that low. In the international journal that I was showing you, it was 95, 96. The first attempt itself, first time we wanted to develop model, we could reach accuracy level of 94, 95, 92, like that. So we got now the interest, energy, and then how to develop even better model using this. And we also learned that to distinguish a bleed from non-bleed, another factor, important factor plays a role is the cutoff point. If I use cutoff as 0.8, some of them will be bleed and some of them will be non-bleed. But if I reduce it to 0.7, then the non-bleed becomes bleed. Now one has to very carefully draw the line that I want to be very specific, or I can be little less specific but more sensitive, because there is a radiologist anyway who will see the data after the AI has predicted. So at least if I see a trace of blood, I should flag it as a bleed. so that at least the radiologist get a chance to see. Now, boring, some of the accuracy truth table that we have generated from our model. As you can see, model C, model E performance, and one is better than the other, so on and so forth. I'll show you three slides that how are we in terms of success or failure. These are some of the images which we predicted as bleeds, and to our satisfaction, even the radiologists found there are bleeds. There are images which said that there are no bleeds, there are no hemorrhages, and even the radiologists agreed with us. There are no images with bleed or anything, any aberrations, at least with respect to bleed. But as you can see, there is a but with everything. There are images where the bleed is actually somewhere outside, very micro, which can only a trained eye can see. Okay, or the finger got rotated, that's why we missed it. So such kind of challenges started coming. And finally, we are in the process of making it available to various districts, hospital level hospitals in our country for identification of the bleed. And happy to say that it is funded by CSIR and it is going to see the daylight in hospitals. But then by the time we are working on this, something more interesting, more challenging, and never seen before kind of problem came, the pandemic COVID-19. And students were there, computer was there. And since this challenge came, we took this challenge. And this time, unfortunately, we did not have those kind of RSNA level images available with us. So we had to start from scratch. This is the team. On the left hand side, you can see some faces, a lot of people having beard and all these 3 months of lockdown, and people working from Pilani, people working from Caring, Teleradiology, and IGIB all together. And we are happy to say that we could develop a world-class performing AI solution that can not only read the chest X-rays, but also it can predict COVID-like pneumonia, COVID pneumonia, or a pneumonia that could be resulting from COVID. And there are in the team, we have got radiologists, India's some of the top radiologists are there, then AI engineers and scientists, all of them are working together hand in hand to develop such a model. What did we get? The methodology looks like this. First challenge was, whenever we give an image, it has to identify whether it is a lung or not a lung, so that somebody should not give a knee X-ray and then it starts saying COVID is there. People will laugh at us. So identifying the lung, then the condition localization, then classification. And in the condition classification, these are some of the features we try to detect. And through an inferencing logic, we say whether it is COVID-like, COVID indeterminate. I mean, the doctor is not able to say whether it is COVID or non-COVID, so indeterminate, or COVID unlikely. Now, how do I tell now whether it is working properly or not? Previous time I told you that it was 95% accuracy, 98% accuracy, whatever that accuracy. So we had a ground truth, a golden truth against which we compared. But here, as you see, there were no ground truth available. So what we did, we requested very senior level 4 radiologists in our country and requested them to look at some 500 cases and tell independently whether if they would have seen a patient like this, would they have told that they are having COVID pneumonia or not? And something very interesting is there in front of you on my screen. Please look at it. It is just not a rangoli, the color combination that you are seeing over here, from left hand side top graph, from leftmost till here, till C2090 number that you are seeing, all four radiologists agreed on their finding. Like all of them either told indeterminate, all of them told likely, all of them told unlikely, at least they were in agreement. Then from middle to the end of the top, there were images where three radiologists agreed on a particular identification. Anyone was disagreeing. That person had a different view. So altogether, we had 315 cases, as you can see here, where three or more radiologists are agreeing on a particular identification. But the beauty is below, where there are cases where two radiologists are telling north, two of them are telling the south. And to the bottom right, there are images where two radiologists are telling A, whereas third one is saying B and fourth one is saying C. So in a situation like this, when we have got so much of discrepancies among these top class doctors, and it can happen also in biology, in healthcare, it happens. They have difference in opinion and all of them are well educated. So what is the ground truth? We do not have a ground truth to compare our tool against. So what we decided, that our AI tool, we can make it as good as a radiologist. We will not compete with anything else on this earth. We will try to match to the label of radiologist. And which radiologist? A majority of radiologists. For example, if I take these 315 cases and know their final verdict, and then take my AI tool, run it through, then I found 240 plus 52, which is 292 out of 315 were absolutely agreed between the radiologist as well as the AI tool. However, always in research, there is a scope for improvement. There were four such cases where RAD was telling unlikely, we were telling likely. And there are 17 such cases where AI was telling likely. Radiologist says, sorry, I'm not seeing anything like that. Research is on. I served you a food which is being cooked. And I hope you liked this entire development process. A large number of people have contributed to the second part of the story, which is the CopeBase. There are doctors, engineers, scientists in this group. And the first part is the CT scan based bleed detection is being done by my PhD scholar who's working with me, Pratik Singh, and is being ably supported by other PhD students in my lab. Thank you for your kind attention. I hope you enjoyed. I see some of the raised hands, some questions being asked. I'm happy to take those questions. If you give me 1 minute, I'll take a sip of water and then.
Yeah, sir. Sure.
Back.
Thank you so much, sir, for a truly remarkable talk. Can we take some questions, sir?
Sure.
For this, I'll invite Dr. Rishu. Please, Rishu, can you take this forward?
Yes, thank you, Ashu.
For any questions, yeah.
Good afternoon, sir. Hello.
Good afternoon.
Sir, I can ask a question. Can AI be a good tool for identifying the pattern of infection?
tool for identifying the pattern of infection. Or can someone explain what is the pattern of infection? Here, if you are asking, can we distinguish between bacterial pneumonia versus viral pneumonia? Yes, we can, because they have different patterns. So, because the doctors believe the COVID infection actually are seen on the periphery of the lungs and equally on the bidirectional. So some of the features are there. So such patterns help in detecting whether it is a COVID or non-COVID.
Okay, thank you, sir. Next is, which clinical operation are best suited for AI today?
Which clinical operations? Again, not
sir,
clear.
Except the, basically, except the radiologist, as you explained, what other operations?
Okay. Now I understood, yes.
Yeah.
So, radiological image reading is what something which I am working on. Otherwise, the AI tool can be applied to almost anything that you can think of. For example, if you look at the ECG graph of a heart patient, that also can be read by an AI tool and tell whether there was an episode of cardiac arrest or not. You can look at the fracture images and tell that whether the fracture is there or not. Again, I'm coming to radiology only, but maybe non-radiologically you can say reading of ECGs, and you can predict if a particular place will get an epidemic or not. If you have collected data over months and years, the way you are predicting weather and all, forecasting weather and all, you can predict even epidemiological infections that can occur, when it will occur, when it will come, what kind of temperature and other kind of environmental parameters suit those. So everywhere, you can think of any problem. I won't say that AI cannot be applied.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for answering the queries. And it was really a wonderful and informative session. So for further proceedings of the session, I would like to invite Dr. Monica. Over to you, Monica, ma'am.
I'll take over first. I'll give you a vote of thanks to sir also first. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for a truly remarkable talk. It was very informative and well explained session, I must say. We are grateful for the time and effort you took to share your thoughts and experiences with us. I believe that our participants, especially students, they have many things to take along with them from your talk. The way you touched the aspects of AI was exceptionally good. The way you touched in details about the machine learning programs process was amazing. And the way you promote, especially for me, I was motivated by this, the way you promote individual learning in different aspects of science is commendable. It's really good. Thank you so much again. And we hope to join with you again soon, sir. Thank you so much. Sir, would you like to say something?
Actually, the pleasure is mine. And I sometimes wonder, Dr. Kaur, how do people get interested in a subject on a Saturday, and then this is subject is probably not their regular subject, and they come to listen to a talk like this? And I'm really overwhelmed, and my sincere thanks to all those listeners. I hope this has given some insight to you. You may directly work, may not work, but at least, yes, you will say that I understand how the AI is working.
So you always explain well every topic. That's
thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. Now, for further proceedings of this program, I'll invite Dr. Monica. Over to you, Monica.
Yeah. Thank you, Ashu. Well, after this absolutely useful session of Professor Debashish, it's time for the valedictory session. This week-long national workshop on emerging trends in science and technology issues in these unprecedented times now comes to its conclusion. I hope and wish each one of us has gained something from this workshop. For the valedictory session, it's my honor to introduce our chief guest, Professor Manoj Kumar Dhar, Honorable Vice Chancellor, University of Jammu. Welcome, sir. We can see you on the screen. Professor Manoj Kumar Dhar holds a master degree in botany from University of Kashmir and was awarded gold medal and certificate of distinction for securing first class first position. His association with University of Jammu has been for the last 34 years since he moved to University of Jammu during 1986 to join for the research program after qualifying NET-JRF and subsequently earned MPhil and PhD degrees in botany, specializing in genetics and cytogenetics. Since 1992, he has been serving University of Jammu in academic as lecturer, reader, and professor, and various administrative capacities such as registrar, controller of examinations, director, academic staff college, etc. He is the founder head of the erstwhile Department of Biotechnology, established in 1998, and also is the inaugural director of the School of Biotechnology, University of Jammu. He has been instrumental in initiating master's and doctoral programs in biochemistry and microbiology and PG diploma in bioinformatics. He served as coordinator of DBT-funded Bioinformatics Center and also of UGC Special Assistance Program sanctioned through the school. He has been coordinator, Rural Technology Action Group, chapter and center coordinator, Institute of Human Genetics. Professor Dhar is the only scientist in J&K state whose work has been recognized by three prestigious science academies of the country. He is the fellow of National Academy of Sciences, India, and fellow of National Academy of Agricultural Sciences. He is also the recipient of Indian National Science Academy Young Scientist Award Medal. Besides, he has several awards and distinctions to his credit. Some of these are Distinguished Scientist Award by Society for Plant Research, Professor Hira Lal Chakravarti Award by the Indian Science Congress Association, Young Scientist Award by J&K State, Department of Science and Technology, Biotechnology Overseas Associateship, Boys Cast Fellowship, Biotechnology National Associateship, and many more. Professor Dhar is a highly trained molecular biologist who has conducted postdoctoral research at Kansas State University, Penn State University, USA, Lebanese Institute of Plant Genetics and Crop Evolution, Germany, National Research Center on Plant Biotechnology, IARI, New Delhi. He was awarded a research project funded by DST India and DAAD Germany. Recently, he was also invited by ITK Germany on a DFG grant to conduct advanced research in super-resolution microscopy. Professor Dhar has established a strong research group on genome research in the University of Jammu. He has been instrumental in establishing state-of-the-art facilities at School of Biotechnology, including next-generation sequencing platform. So far, he has supervised 24 students for PhD, 7 for MPhil degrees, has about 150 publications in reputed national and international journals to his credit. His research group has made significant contribution to genomics of several horticultural crops of high value and relevance to J&K. Professor Dhar is the principal investigator of major network projects funded by Department of Biotechnology, Government of India, on apple, saffron, and tomato. He has taken a novel initiative to establish a national germ plasma repository of apple at Bahadurgarh campus of the university, wherein about 300 varieties of apple are being maintained. He has been able to attract extramural funding to the tune of about 18 crores from different funding agencies for creating the research facilities at School of Biotechnology. His recent work on rare genetic disorders published in Nature Scientific Reports has been widely acclaimed. Professor Dhar has served on several national committees. He is the member of DBT Government of India Task Force on Human Resource Development and has served as member of DST Expert Committee for Young Scientist Projects SERV program Advisory Committee on Plant Sciences, to name a few. He has been a member of Academic Council of SKUAST Jammu and Kashmir. University Grant Commission has nominated him a member of the Advisory Committee of SAP DRS in Biotechnology of HP University and Kashmir University. Within University of Jammu, he has immensely contributed to the corporate life as chairman or as member of various committees. Currently, he is a member Medical Advisory Council of National Medical Commission of India. He is also the member of the Executive Council of almost all the universities of the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. So we are really delighted to have you amongst us here today. I now invite our principal, sir, Professor Ravi Narayan Kar, for the welcome address. Over to you, sir. Sir, please unmute yourself.
Am I audible now?
Sir, a little more volume.
Is it okay?
So you still, now you're audible. Yeah.
Okay. So first of all, thank you, Dr. Monica. And thank you, Professor Devasis, for a wonderful session. Though I am not from science, but the topic, the way you have made it so easy for people like us to not only understand, trying to, you know, visualizing a lot of things to implement in my own institution, for which I'm sure you will be collaborating with us as you have been mentoring. And once again, thank you a lot. And with this also, I would like to extend a very warm welcome to the Honorable Vice Chancellor, University of Jammu, Professor Manoj Dhar. Sir, thank you for joining us. And first of all, I would, from your biodata, also we knew it earlier that Professor Dhar is a leading scientist of this country. And another thing at SLC also, sir, we are trying to bring not only botany honors, we have a vision of, you know, shifting towards biotech also. So I would request you to mentor, not only mentor and partner, collaborate with in our endeavors also in future. And this is just the beginning that we have this DBT Star project has come to us. And I'm sure, sir, in future also, all of the leading scientists of this country, always we believe in, we are no lesser. So always our endeavor to bring in the best so that my faculty, my students should, you know, enrich themselves, they should get the best. So with this thought process, this is the initial workshop, sir, we have organized, where you will be happy to know that more than 12 to 14 eminent scientists from India, they have addressed and they have interacted with the voting scientists and students. So with this initial remarks, once again, thank you very much for having joined our endeavor. And this workshop is organized under the aegis of the DBT Star College program with, in collaboration with our IQAC. I hope for the IQAC coordinator, Dr. Kusha Tiwari, she's also in the program. So a little bit in a lot of things also, as you have happened to be a guiding pillar in your own university for last 30 years in different capacities also. So we also want to take some cues from you so that we can make a lot of things not only functional and progress towards excellence. So over to Dr. Kusha Tiwari. Thank you, sir, once again.
May I request Kusha to please come?
Thank you, Monica. Thank you, sir, for encouraging words towards IQAC. I would like to also thank the chief guest of the valedictory session, Honorable Vice Chancellor of University of Jammu. It has been a very enriching experience, and I can see there has been almost over 200 participants every day. So I really congratulate the organizers, the Department of Physics and Department of Chemistry, for organizing this 1-week workshop, as well as the coordinators of DBT. Thank you so much, and I'm really waiting to hear the chief guest of the valedictory session today. Thank you.
Thank you. Now may I request our chief guest, Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, to please address the audience. Sir, over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Monica. And first of all, let me express my sincere thanks to the principal, Professor R.N. Kar, the principal of Shyamlal College of University of Delhi. It's a great pleasure and privilege to be here this afternoon and for a valedictory session of, I would say, a week-long program which you have organized, and I could see that there has been enormous feedback. What I can read from the chat box, the feedback is that this
is from sir's side. There is some issues in the network connection. Kindly unmute.
Yes. Now I have.
Yeah. Now it is okay, sir. Please proceed.
So okay. So I think there was some interruption. I couldn't. So anyway, I'll repeat. I said this is indeed a matter of great honor and privilege for me to be here this afternoon and attending the valedictory function of a very successfully conducted webinar. And let me first of all congratulate Professor Kar, who is the principal of the college, and the entire team, Dr. Monica, Dr. Ashu, if I can remember the names, and Dr. Kusha, I think I just heard her. And it's really wonderful to see that you have had a very good participation in this program, and still I can see about 200 participants are there who are attending this program. My congratulations and best wishes. I am sure that you must have had a very thought-provoking discussion every day and on various aspects of science and technology. And I'm sure that a lot must have been said already about science and technology emerging trends. So I may avoid the repetition of what must have been already said in all these days. But I just thought that in a webinar which is being held today, something which happened yesterday, so I think I would bring forth those points before you. You know, yesterday we had a day-long meeting by the MHRD where our Honorable Prime Minister, Shri Narendra Modi ji, he talked about how this new education policy is going to make revolutionary changes in our curriculum, and how we are, as a country, we are going to adopt to this new education policy. And one of the things, in fact, there is a lot in this new education policy which needs to be adapted and which needs to be put in place for the benefit of our students. But something which he said yesterday and which is really relevant so far as science and technology is concerned is, he said that, and I quote, Honorable Prime Minister yesterday said that our earlier emphasis of higher education has been on what to think. But with this new education policy, this emphasis from what to think will change to how to think. So I think there is a lot which he has actually tried to communicate within these two sentences. And if we really see the meaning of this, I must say that there is a lot which our students can do, provided they are provided the opportunities of innovative thinking, curiosity. And when we say emerging trends in science and technology, the pandemic which we are facing at the moment, has actually taught us many things, and out of those many things, I think the important thing is that we need to take the natural resources, the nature, environment, these things need to be taken very, very seriously. And if we see just a small virus, millions of them, if you collect together millions of these viruses, they will still be about a pinhead, size of a pinhead. Yet you can see that how much of havoc this virus, coronavirus, is causing, and the humanity is almost helpless. We are waiting for the vaccine, or we are waiting for different kinds of drugs which can help us. So there is a lot of opportunity. There are lots of things which can be done, and in almost every field, since I belong to biology, so I will say that there is tremendous amount of gap so far as technology is concerned, and so far as the challenges are concerned which are confronting us. So there's a lot to be done, provided we go in a very systematic manner, and we enthuse our students to really go out and learn from different things. Not necessarily everything can be taught in a classroom, so something to go out and learn and see that how we can provide solutions to the real life challenges, rather than conducting research or conducting research in areas which can may not be really of that importance, in the sense that we may be repeating what others have done, something which has been done in some other organism, we are doing it in another organism, rather than do some innovative research, whether it is basic or whether it is applied, we do that. So I think there's a lot which can be done, and especially in this era, in this period, when we are facing this problem, almost all the educational institutions, including colleges, universities, are facing this difficulty of transacting the curriculum. How to transact? We are all talking in terms of digital ways by which we could conduct the classwork, by which we could conduct the examinations, e-learning, planning, teaching, learning, and other aspects. Training of teachers, in fact, that again is being thought. Not many of the teachers are ready today to apply these digital technologies for transacting the curriculum. And what about the practicals? What about the real experiments which have to be done in the classes? So I think the entire focus of our education system has to be changed. And that is all what is there in the new education policy as well. So we need to move towards what is now being called as blended teaching, in terms of both online as well as offline teaching. And the early we start, the better it is, because when there is a phrase that catch them early, catch them young. So when we talk of our students, there are hardly any occasions when a student is allowed to think innovatively, or do something which where there is risk. We don't actually encourage our students to go for taking risks in various, there may be failures, but then one has to take risk. So I think the whole perspective of our thinking towards developing the future scientists, the developing the future technologies has to change, and the time is there. And I take this pandemic era, I think it has given us more opportunities to think in terms of that. Let us see the positive side of the pandemic. So it is giving us more opportunities to think about these aspects. So therefore, what in my opinion, I think that when we say that we have to prepare our students for future, we have to have future scientists, I think that kind of work atmosphere, that kind of curriculum which encourages them to do innovative things, to practice such things where they can take risks, something new can happen, something novel can come out of their fields. So that is perhaps the need of the hour. I am sure that I have talked a little different than what must have been discussed, because when we talk of emerging technologies, there are thousands of them, and in every field, especially in the new areas like artificial intelligence, material science, there are lot many things which are happening and which are required even in medical science as well as other areas of research. But at the same time, we have to, because we are dealing with students, we are dealing with the future budding scientists, scholars who would be the leaders of tomorrow. So I think these aspects, they have to be blended with our curriculum as well, so that we provide them that kind of space, we provide them that kind of opportunity that they can come out with new and better technologies of future. So again, I would say that it's indeed a pleasure to be here. And of course, I missed all the discussions and the topics and lectures by the eminent scientists whom you have and other academicians whom you have invited. Yet, I think from the summary, I will get an idea as to what all has happened all these days. So with my best wishes, and Principal Saab has requested me to help so far as the biotechnology program or even general biology program is concerned. I know it's a DBT star college program wherein the idea is to involve all the sciences. They not only focus on biotechnology, but I have been earlier associated with this program. But I know that we encourage all sciences, physics, chemistry, biology, mathematics, computer science, all together are being encouraged to work in tandem. And in fact, that is what is required. We need to remove these barriers of different subjects, and we need to take these as a holistic view. An interdisciplinary view has to be taken. Otherwise, we have created those artificial cells that somebody would study only physics and somebody would say study only chemistry or biology. But I think that those walls have to go. We have to have this interdisciplinary approach in understanding science. And therefore, principles of this, I would say that whenever you feel like my intervention is required or I am ready to help you in setting up a good department, biotechnology, I have done it in my university, so it's not difficult for me.